Find me with my heart bowed down. could see. He walked on the waters, he fed the hungry, cleansed the leper. But we need Jesus now more than ever. Jesus now more than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All His children should get together. For we need Jesus now more than ever. He touched the lame man and he started walking. He touched the dumb man and he started talking. He put their lives all back together. But we need Jesus now more than ever. Jesus now more than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All His children should get together. In the book of Revelation, we read about the tribulation. We are led in that direction. Only Jesus' love can give direction. Only Jesus more than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All His children should get together. Here we need Jesus now more than ever. Jesus now more than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All His children should get together. For we need Jesus now more than ever. For we need, yes, we need Jesus now.
Take your Bibles, if you would, please, and open this morning to the book of Acts. The book of Acts, you wonder why we're in the book of Acts, because Acts is good. And since we've been going through all the first of the book of Acts, I have enjoyed reading over and over the book of Acts to familiarize myself more with it and all that's been going on, especially now that we've entered into missions and how missions has started and its origin and where it's began and how it's moving about. And we come to this, the 17th chapter of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 17, and we find that the Apostle Paul had been in Thessalonica, and things didn't quite go well there. They actually snuck him out by night, and he joined up with Silas and Timothy over in Berea. And there's where they had a great reception and a great study of God's word as they looked at the word of God with the Bereans. And it came time for Paul to depart, and the Bereans escorted him to Athens. And we find Paul down now in Athens. And he's there awaiting for Silas and Timothy to join him. But in the meantime, some things happened in Athens. Paul approaches the city and looks down on the city. And of course, you know, this is where that great debate went on at Mars Hill there. And we find that Paul runs into this city and his heart is totally taken by it, under extreme distress, as he looks at the city and he sees an entire city, an entire populated city, overtaken by idolatry. And the entire city was involved in idol worship, idolatry, and just Paul's heart was just totally broken and distressed over it. And the preacher finds himself, as the preacher, the urgency of who needs the gospel. As he sees this city of Athens, as he comes into it, and he runs into six different people groups, we could call them, and every one of us is in one of these people groups. Everyone that's watching today by television and listening on the radio and the internet and YouTube, you'll find yourself in one of these people groups. And Paul's heart and desire is that these folks of Athens, as well as all of you that are watching and listening, would come to know the Savior, because everyone needs Jesus. And Paul knew that Athens desperately needed Jesus, and so there was an urgency for him to preach Christ to them at Athens. And so that's where we find ourselves, and that's the first thing we're going to take a look at, is these six people groups that Paul runs into, and then we'll begin to see his message and how they respond to the message of the gospel. And so let me draw your attention to it. We'll read some of these verses here, 16 through 21. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him. That means he was distressed when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore, disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and the Stoics encountered him. And some said, "What will this babbler say?" Others some, "He seemeth to be a settler forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." You see, everybody's okay with preaching Jesus, but when you get on the resurrection, they have a problem. You see, and they took him and they brought him unto Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears, and we would know therefore what these things mean." For all the Athenians and the strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Everybody's wanting to hear a new thing. Everybody's looking for a new thing. Churches today are trying to do everything they can do to come up with a new thing and something new and new doctrine and new to the ears. And folks, there's nothing wrong with the old thing. Right. See, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And the gospel's not broke. And it's not an old thing. It's a new thing, by the way, for a lot of people that's never had it and never come to know Christ. So let's pray together. Father, thank you for the passage today. And we praise you and we thank you for it. We bless you, Lord. We bless your holy name. And now, Father, please bring to remembrance the things that Jesus has said to us. Father, may you anoint our heart and lips and mind at this time. We ask for your anointing on this word today, that the word of God will go out in strength and in power from this place, and that it will not fall on deaf ears. And those that will hear it around the world, around this globe, those that are involved in one of these six groups, that they will come to know the Lord Jesus Christ and respond to the gospel message. And Father, we'll thank you for it. We'll give you praise for it in Jesus' mighty name. And in faith we pray and believe it. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Let's begin to take a look at it, of the message of the preacher here. Paul's the preacher, and he finds himself in one of the most intellectual and cultural centers of the world, and that is Athens. Athens prided themselves on intellect. philosophy and all these philosophers and philosophical things and questions and answers, and that's what they spent most of their time on. And then in idolatry. And by the way, folks, idolatry is anything that's above God. Anything you put before God is idolatry. I don't care if it's family, that's idolatry. I don't care if it's your children or grandchildren. If they come before God, that's an idolatry. Because thou shalt have no other gods before me, Jesus said. Thou shalt not bow down to any graven images. Well, there was a lot of graven images here in Athens. They had statues of stone everywhere. They knew all about all the pagan gods and the pagan deities. So just in case they could cover it all, they put one up for the unknown god, just in case, so they could have it all taken care of. And they were much into this philosophy and debating and questions and idolatry. I want to tell you, if you put money before God, that's idolatry. If you put pleasure before God, that's idolatry. If you put materialism before God, that's idolatry. You see, anything that comes before the worship of the true and living God is called idolatry. And Paul stands outside the city as he approaches it, and his heart breaks and yearns as he sees a whole city and its population taken over in idolatry. And there he realizes the urgency of his message. I've got to get down there to Athens, and I must preach Christ unto them and the resurrection. Because, you see, that's what the gospel's all about, is the resurrection. No resurrection, no gospel. No resurrection, no message. You see, everybody didn't have a problem with these guys preaching about Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One. He was a miracle healer. He was a miracle worker. He went about doing good. He was a good rabbi. He was a good teacher. And I mean, they had no problem. They even had no problem with preaching about, yeah, they knew the Jews put him on a cross and then the Romans killed him. They knew that he was buried. They knew that he would put in a tomb. And everything was fine until they started mentioning the resurrection. And as soon as they started that, they came apart. And no different here. But there are six people groups here, and we're going to find ourselves in one of them. And so here we are in this cultural center, this highly intelligent educational center of the world, and we find the preachers distressed. And I want you to notice in the second verse there, it says, notice when you look at that one word, daily. Circle that word in verse 17, daily. In other words, Paul preached Christ and the resurrection daily. Hey, folks, not just on Sunday morning. Not just Sunday night or Wednesday night, but daily. That's the urgency of the message of the hour we live in today, that we must daily get the message of the gospel out to a lost and dying world. And thank God we have all the technology today and the equipment and everything available to us to do so. And thank the Lord that this church is doing that. And we praise God for that as it goes out around the globe as we speak, as it was live streamed last night, as it's live streamed at 2:30 a.m. in the morning on Thursday from 55 around the world. It goes out. What does the gospel message of Jesus Christ? We thank God we had a call from YouTube person this week that was watching us on YouTube. And we thank God we had one call that was watching us on the internet this week on our website, you see, and having questions about the message and of the gospel of Christ. And most of it was about the rapture and do we really believe in it? Is it really going to happen? And of course, that's a good subject I like. And so I had no problem for 45 minutes having a good conversation on the rapture of the church and Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, after that, I wore my church. We got shirt. We got here. Separation of church and state. The true separation of church and state is the rapture. And I've worn that thing for 4 or 5 days. Now it's time to wash it. Amen. All right, because it's probably getting strong. But oh, praise God. One guy was watching me in the line. And he just kept staring at it. He kept staring at it. I just kept smiling at him. And he says, what is all this? And I said, that's the rapture, man. You want separation of church and state? Then get saved and go with me in the rapture. You see, that's what it's all about. And so we praise God. So let's take a look. So what's he doing? He's daily preaching Jesus and the resurrection to six different people groups. So the first group I want you to notice here in verse 17, therefore disputed he where? Ah, with who? Ah, that's the religious crowd. That's the religious crowd. That's where he started right off the bat, was in the synagogue with the religious crowd. Because you want to know who needs to get saved the most today is the religious people. That, we got a lot of bunch of people who are religious, but they're lost. Religion's not going to save you. Religion isn't going to forgive you. Religion isn't going to give you a home in heaven. Religion isn't going to get your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. All religion is doing is going to kill you and send you to a devil's hell. Religion is man-made. Religion is a bunch of do's and don'ts, and religion is a bunch of culture and rituals and all kinds of stuff, of ceremonials. See, that's religion. We're talking about a relationship with a real person named Jesus Christ that'll change your life now and for eternity. Religion won't do anything but kill a dead man in a graveyard at midnight. You see, that's what religion will do. So that you can see the urgency. I'm telling you, church, America, religious people need Jesus. You don't need religion. We got all the religion we want, never have to need at 24/7 on the clock. What you need is Jesus. That's what you need. You need the gospel of Jesus Christ, not religion. That's the first group. Then the next group, he says the devout person. You look that word up, devout, then that means God-fearing people. How many of you know some God-fearing people? Folks, we got a lot of God-fearing people, but they're lost. You can be God-fearing all you want and still be lost and not know Christ. You see, you can see the urgency of even of God-fearing people. I know something else, not only God-fearing people, but Jesus said even the demons believe God and they tremble. We won't even tremble. So you see, being a God-fearing person, my friend, doesn't make you a Christian, doesn't make you a believer in Jesus Christ. So you see, you could be in that group as a religionist person today, or a highly religious person. You could be in that group as a God-fearing person, and we ought to fear God. There's nothing wrong with that, you see. But then there's another group there, and the market daily with them that met with him. Now he's down to talking about the everyday citizen, the average person. That's where most of us probably find ourselves today. We're the average person. We're the average citizen. Amen? And so guess what? They need Jesus too. Paul said they need Jesus too, and he met daily with them in the marketplace with the average person on the street. The average citizen on the street today, folks, I want to tell you, needs Jesus Christ. You walk in a Walmart, you walk in a supermarket, you walk into wherever you want to go, Wally World, China World, whatever you want to call it, you see, or at Kmart and Publix and Winn-Dixie. I can guarantee you probably 90% of the people when you're in there at that time is lost without Christ. And they need Jesus. What you need is an urgency in your heart that they need Christ. And that's where you need to step up to the plate and share Christ with them. Give them a track. Invite them to church. If you can't talk to them, bring them here. I'll talk to them. Bring them to Sunday school, and he'll talk to them. Amen? Get them here. Get them here. Well, I go to church on Sunday morning. Good. Come to our Sunday night and hear the gospel. So we have what group so far? How many groups of people we got? We got the religious people, okay? Then we got the God-fearing people. Now we got the average person or the average citizen. Now he comes to these Epicureans. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and the Stoics. Now there's two more people there, the Epicureans and the Stoics. Now the Epicureans, these are pleasure seekers. You look that word up, and they're pleasure seekers. Boy, does that describe America today. We have become a nation of pleasure seekers. And I want to tell you, pleasure seekers need Jesus. Pleasure seekers need the gospel of Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, over in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 4, the Bible says that men love pleasure more than they love God. And boy, have we become a nation of that. And I'm even talking about people that claim to be saved, people that claim to be born again, are caught up in this pleasure seeking. And everything is pleasure, pleasure, pleasure. Got to have pleasure, pleasure. Well, there's the fourth group of people. I want to tell you, pleasure people seekers need Jesus. Pleasure seekers need the gospel. Then he comes to the Stoics, this group. Oh, these are the rigid, self-disciplined people. Man, they live by the letter of the law. They're so disciplined and so rigid in their ceremonials and their rituals and their do's and their don'ts and their list and nothing more than what we would call today a modern legalist. Are you with me? Say amen. Come on, church, talk to me. So that's another group. See, you're going to be in one of these groups or another. Well, you can be the legalist all you want to. You can be a self-disciplined all you want to, but I want to tell you something. You still need Jesus. See, you don't need all your rules and your do's and your don'ts and your laws and your rituals and your ceremonials. What you need is Jesus. You don't need more churches on the corner. We got a church on every corner. What we need is Jesus, you see. That's what we need. We don't need pleasure seekers because we got all the pleasure in the world we could ever want. What we need is Jesus. People in the world need Jesus. People need the Lord. That's why it's playing out there on that program that we had Dr. Woodard put on for our mission board. Praise God, he let my wife sing it. People need the Lord, and they need the gospel. So there's that group. Then we come to the philosophical questioners, the philosophers. Here we go, look at them. And some said, that's in verse 18, what will this babbler say? So I guess I'm a babbler. Amen. Look at the philosophical questioners here of Christ. Here's what they go. What will this babbler say? Question. Other some. He seemeth to be a setter of forth of strange gods. Here's why. Why is this? Because what did he do? He preached recreation unto them. He preached fun and games. He preached entertainment unto them. Because that's what our churches are doing today. Now again, I'm going to tell you, how you get them is how you got to keep them. If that's how you get them, that's how you got to keep them. And when that stops, guess where they go? Down the street to the next church with the same thing. And then if that church splits up and breaks up, there's nothing left because there's no substance. There's no strength. There's no stability. There's no maturity, you see. No, what did Paul do? He preached Jesus unto them. He preached, now what's another word for Jesus? He preached the Messiah unto them. He preached Christ, the anointed one, unto them. But you see, he just didn't stop with preaching the Messiah. He just didn't stop with preaching the anointed one. He preached Jesus and the resurrection. You see, that's what got them, boy. These philosophers blew their philosophical mind. What's this resurrection stuff? What's this new thing we hear? Because we spend all day and all of our time wondering about what's what and what's who's what and telling and hearing. That's what the verse 21 said they did. Aimlessly, there is what that means. They were aimless. They were meaningless. They were empty. Who? These philosophers. Oh, I'll tell you what. What a group. What a group. And so they confronted Paul here, and they got upset. They were disturbed about the resurrection. See, people get disturbed about the resurrection. Folks, you realize that Jesus, over 15 different places and over 15 different times, proved himself from the grave, that he arose from the grave? Every one of the disciples several times, and as a group, other brothers and sisters in Christ on the road to Emmaus, at the grave itself. I mean, oh my goodness, in the house the first time, in the house the second time, and at one time he was seen of over 500 brethren. Oh my goodness, come on, folks. And if you count it all up and add it up, some scholars say that there over 1,500 people were eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So Paul went down there and he says, and by the way, Paul says, I'm a believer because in chapter 9, I got saved. Because in chapter 8, I was raising hell with the church. I was putting them in prison. I was there stoning Stephen. I was going after to get them, boy. Men and women, it didn't make no difference. But on the road to Damascus, and I was going up there to get a handful of them. He said, boy, all of a sudden the light that outshined the sun was the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Why kickest thou against the pricks? And I fell to the ground and said, Lord, who art thou, Lord? He knew who he was. He confessed with his mouth. And he was blinded for 3 days. And then when he went to Ananias' house, God told Ananias to listen to me now, for he is my chosen vessel. Now think about it. I thought about this week. For he is my chosen vessel, Paul. And I will show unto him how much great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Now I got to thinking about that for a moment. Now this isn't in the message. This is extra. We reap what we sow. Are you with me? What did Paul do with Christians and the church? He had them killed. He had them beat. He had them put in prison. Come on, tell me about Paul's life. Paul wrote over half the New Testament where? In prison. Paul says how many times he was beaten with stripes. Huh? And Paul ended up in Rome and got his head cut off. Huh? You see, folks, we can get saved, but there's still consequences of our sin. You see, we're going to reap what we sowed. And Paul reaped everything he sowed against the church and Jesus Christ before he got saved. There's still consequences. Did God forgive him? Yes. Were they washed in the blood of the Lamb? Yes. Were they parted as far as the east as the west? Yes. Were they put behind God's back, never to be remembered again? Yes. Were they buried in the depths of the sea and a sign put up, no fishing? Yes. But there were still consequences for the sin. And Paul reaped everything he did to the church. I thought, wow, God's word's really true. We do reap what we sow. Doesn't matter even if we're an apostle. Hello. So here's a guy who says, man, I will tell you something. You talk about a resurrection. I saw him. I saw him. He was so bright he blinded me. I saw him and he talked to me. And oh, they did, they just couldn't handle it. So that brings us to where we're going now. Verse 22, he starts off. Here's the message. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. Huh? He listened to them in the first six verses or eight verses there. Now it's time for the preacher to speak. For as I passed by and I beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship. But watch this. Him declare I unto you. Paul said, fasten your seatbelts here at Athens, you men. Get ready. I'm going to declare to you, to the very one that you worship, that you don't even know exists. And then here he goes to all of these philosophers and these Epicureans and these Stoics and the common folks and the religious people and the self-disciplined people and the God-fearing people. He gets up and he begins to preach to them here this wonderful message. And he says, the first thing I want you to know, that God is even sought after by superstitious men. He reminds them, he says, God is even sought after by superstitious men. See, Paul's going to get them, conclude them all in this, okay? Are you with me? Oh, good. And then he says here, you write this thing about to this unknown God. He says, I want to tell you secondly, God is not unknown. Come on, how many can agree with me? God is not unknown and God is not hidden. You don't need a subscription to this unknown statue or plaque that you've put up to the unknown God. Men at Athens, I want to tell you, you can know him. He's right here. He's not unknown. He's not hidden. And he's not even hidden to you superstitious guys. This is his message. He's just getting started. He comes down to verse 24. And now he begins, and now he's told them that God is sought by superstitious men. Then he tells them that God is not hidden. He tells them that God is not unknown. He says, look at here. And he begins to declare unto them. He says, the first thing I want you to know, that God is the creator. Look what he says in verse 24. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is the Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. In other words, he says, God is the creator. He is the Lord of heaven and earth. You can go to John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then it goes on to say that not anything that was made that wasn't made by him, that all things were made for him, and of him, and by him, you see. Paul said, I want to tell you something. You know what Paul was doing? Quoting John 1:1 and John 1:2 to them, he said. And then only that, he says, not only that, he's not in these buildings. He's not in these statues that you've erected. He's not in these temples that you have all over the place here in Athens. No, no. He says God is ever present. He's omnipresent. That's his attribute. God is everywhere. You can't hide from him, and he's not hiding from you. You can run, but you can't hide. And so he's telling them, God, first, he starts right off, God is the creator. Look at this. He goes to verse 25. Neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he need anything, seeing he giveth what? To all life and breath and all things. In other words, God is the creator, not the created. You understand that? That's what he's telling them. Matter of fact, he's self-sufficient. God doesn't need anything. He's okay all by himself. He's got everything under control. He's got it all taken care of. God doesn't need anything. He's self-sufficient. Notice what else that he tells him. He says, and by the way, he says, fellas, because of that, he is the giver of life and breath and to everything else. God is the giver of life and breath to everything. You understand that? That's why the psalmist said, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Even the trees of the field clap their hands and praise the Lord. Even the animal kingdom that has breath praises the Lord. The birds, even out on a cold morning, are praising the Lord. The squirrels that run around all over the place are praising the Lord. My dog praises the Lord. I'm telling you, you can talk to her about the Lord. You can mention to her about Jesus. You know why? Because she hears it all the time, you see. And so she hears it, and you ask her, and boy, she begins to hoop and holler and praise the Lord. And you ask her, are you praising the Lord? Yes, 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 yes. Do you love Jesus? Yes, 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 yes. I even ask her, are you saved? And she goes, yes, yes. I said, are you going to heaven? She goes, yes, yes. I said, are you ready for the rapture for the Lord to come? And she just shuts her head back and says, yes, yes. Even God's creation moaneth and groaneth for the coming of the Lord. I'm telling you, friend, everything that has breath, give God the praise. You can laugh about all the animals you want to, but I know a donkey that saved a man. Turned around and talked to him. Hey, stupid. What do you beat me these three times? Haven't I pulled your cart? Haven't I done this for you? Haven't I done? Oh, I can imagine Balaam was going, oh, man, so I've lost my mind. I've got dementia. I've got Alzheimer's. Something wrong with me. This donkey's talking to me. I mean, here's a jackass that's talking to me. I mean, in plain Hebrew language. And he says, hey, idiot, can't you see that angel standing up there with a flaming sword? What's your problem, man? I'm telling you, there's going to be a time in the millennium God's going to loosen the tongues of the animals, and they're going to talk to us. I was in Winn-Dixie the other day, and an old gentleman walked in. He comes in all the time, and he has a big old green parrot up on his shoulder, and he's walking around with that parrot. You can hear that thing all over the whole store. That parrot was just a talking up a storm. And he said he'd come in here when he first walked in. As soon as that guy walked in the store of Winn-Dixie, the parrot goes, what y'all doing? What y'all doing? And I said, well, this is great. I said, we're shopping. He goes, shopping, shopping, shopping. And I asked the man, I said, what are you? Is he a girl or boy? He said, oh, he's a little girl. I said, oh, you're a pretty little girl, amen? I said, you're a pretty little girl? She fluffed up. Woo, woo. Woo, woo! I mean, oh, but she knew she was a pretty little girl. Oh, I'm telling you. And how are you? I mean, it's just fantastic. One of these days, the Sadie lives, and Jesus coming, he'll open her mouth. And she's going to give God praise. So then look at verse 26. So he tells us that God's not hidden. God's not unknown. He says that God is sought after even by superstitious men. He tells us that God's the creator of heaven and earth. He's the creator of the giver of life and breath. Then in verse 26, he says, by the way, he guides men through history. He guides the history of all men and nations and hath made one blood. How many? One blood of what? All nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth and hath determined the time before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. In other words, God is the God of all men, come from one source. What source is that? Adam. We come from Adam, okay? We all come from one source. And then we also understand that he gives men a time and a space to live on this planet. He gives men a time and a place and a space to live on this planet. He gives 70, that's 70. If by reason one more score, that's 80. After that, we're really living on grace and borrowed time. Amen? And if we get past that point. But he also says after that, it is appointed unto man once to die. After that, the judgment. So I have an appointed time. I have a time, and God has put me on this planet for a space and a time to inhabit it for his glory, for his praise, for his honor. We're not here just to take up space. We're not here just because God needed somebody to walk around on this planet. Oh, no, my friend. We're here to share the gospel. We're here to get people saved and born again. Why? Because the world needs Jesus. The six people groups need Jesus. And Paul's urgency in his heart was, I must preach Christ and the resurrection of the Lord to these men and women at Athens here because they so desperately need the Lord. Verse 27, he begins to tell them that God had a great purpose for you, and that is a great purpose for creating man. You see that God had a purpose for creating you. Look at verse 27. That they should seek the Lord. What is your purpose for your creation today? He told them that they would seek the Lord. And the Bible says, Jesus said, seek me and you shall find me. Seek me early and you shall find me. Search with me with all your heart and you shall find me. Friend, I'm telling you today, if you will seek for the Lord, if you will search for the Lord, you can find him. He's not hidden. He's not unknown. He's omnipresent. He's right near. He's right there. Just call upon him to save you. Wow, that's not hard. And yet people want to make it so difficult. Want to make it so difficult. Don't understand it. My purpose was creating was to seek the Lord, and not only to seek him, but to know him. God wants us to know him. Look what he says there in the verse here. He keeps on. That thou should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him. That means to know him and find him. Though he be not far from every one of us. Look at verse 28. For in him we, what? Church, talk to me. For in him we live and move and have our being. In other words, we are the very offspring of God himself. How many would agree with that? Adam, we come from Adam and we are the very offspring of God. And because that's what God said in Genesis, if you go back to the very beginning, he said, let us make man and in our image and in our likeness. So we are the offspring of God. And because we are the offspring of God, we have a responsibility to seek him out. We have a responsibility to seek out God and to know God. Why? We're his offspring. And you know what? If they're your offspring, you want to know your father. Hello. And so this is what Paul's telling them. He said, man, your purpose is to seek him. Your purpose is to find him. Your purpose is to know him. He's not far off. You're his offspring. But so how does one do that? Well, I'm glad you asked, because in verse 29, he tells them. For as much as we are the offspring of God, ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone or graven by the art of man's device. And at the times of this ignorance, God winked at. But now, talk to me, church, commandeth all men everywhere to repent. God demands repentance from his offspring. Why? Because of sin. You know what their sin problem was? Idolatry. What is your sin problem today? If there's anything standing between you and God, then your sin is idolatry too. And God wants you to repent of that idolatry. God says that he wants men everywhere and allwhere to repent. Matter of fact, Jesus put it this way one time. He says, I tell you likewise, unless you all repent, you shall all likewise perish. Unless you repent, you shall perish. And today, people don't want to repent. The church doesn't want to repent today. God's people don't even want to repent today. We've become happy with our situation, happy with our lives. We've become satisfied and content with the way we are and what we're doing, and yet we need repentance more than ever. And God says, hey, this time, you remember when Paul earlier he talked to me, he says, you're ignorant of this thing. You're ignorant that God's not known in everywhere, he says. And so God winked at their ignorance. And Paul says, now there's no excuse for ignorance. Ladies and gentlemen, those of you that are watching and listening still with us right now on the television and everything, there's no excuse for ignorance today. There's absolutely no excuse for ignorance today to know God. He's here. He's right there. If you just call upon him, if you just repent and believe in your heart and receive the Lord, and believe in the resurrection, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God, what? Raised him from the dead. There's the gospel. There's the resurrection that'll bring salvation to your heart, you see. But men and women don't want to do that. And yet everywhere people need the Lord. These people groups need the gospel. And it's our responsibility, church, to get the gospel out. It's our responsibility to get the gospel out. And Paul says, no excuses no more. You know why there's no excuses anymore? You know why Paul was telling this crowd as he's standing there on Mars Hill to all these great philosophers and these intellectuals and these highly intellectuals there? You know why he tells us there's no excuse? He says, because number one, he said, I just got through telling you that God seeks after superstitious men. Number two, he said, I just got through telling you that God's not hidden and that God's not unknown. He said, number three, I just got through telling you that God is your creator. He said, number four, I just got through telling you that he guides you through history and the nations. Number five, he says, I just got through telling you his great purpose, and that is for you, for creating you, was to seek him and to know him. And he says, and I just got through telling you, that's why you need to repent. So he says, there's no excuse. And you can go to Romans chapter 1, and the Bible says, Paul said, they will be without excuse. He'll say, well, what about those missionaries, and what about those people way off in the dark tribes of Africa or somewhere around the world, the Indians and different groups and so forth? You read chapter 1, and the Bible makes it very clear that even though I don't get over there as a missionary, you don't get over there, or our television, and they don't have an iPad or an iPhone out there in the middle of the bush. The Bible says, Paul said, that even nature itself preaches the gospel that God is alive and well, and that people can be saved and repent by just looking at everything that he's made around you. There's no excuse. And today, no one has an excuse, because the gospel today is being preached around the world. And by the way, that's a good sign. See, they wanted to know when would be the sign when Jesus would come. Oh, there'll be wars and rumors of wars, and there'll be all kinds of things and troubles and all kinds of tribulation and everything. But he said, the end is not yet. The end is not yet. But Jesus told them when the end would be. He said, when this gospel is preached around the world, then shall the end come. And I'm telling you, we're living in that day. We're living in that day where the gospel literally is being preached around the world today. All over the place. Some 207, 209 countries around the world, and we're going to the gospel in there. I know for a fact that, praise the Lord, TBN, Trinity Broadcasting Network, right now is broadcasting the gospel in 197 countries around the world, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Now, I don't agree with everything that's on there, but I still agree when they mention Jesus' name, and when they say he is the Savior, he is the Messiah, he is the Son of the living God, he is the Christ, and you must be born again, and you must be saved and washed in the blood. I agree with that doctrine, that sound doctrine, my friend. And oh, it's going around the world 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And even this little church right here is putting out the gospel around the world 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I don't care where they live on the planet of the globe. If they've got a tablet, they got an iPhone, they got a Droid phone, I don't care what you got, a Verizon phone, an Apple phone, iPad, tablet, taboo, whatever. Whatever you got, television, radio, internet, the gospel is there. Men and women are without excuse today. And Paul says God winked at their ignorance. He said there's no need for ignorance anymore. You're without excuse. What are you going to do with the message I just preached to you? That's what he asked them. Look at the next verse. We're just about done. Verse 31. Because, hear what he just tell them to do. Repent. He said, repent. Why? Because he hath appointed a day. Say that with me. He hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world. And how's he going to judge the world? In righteousness. In other words, God has set a time, God has set a day that he's going to judge the world. He's going to execute judgment. How? In righteousness. Who's he going to do it by? Keep on reading. By that man. Who's that man? Whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. Jesus Christ one day will judge the world. God has placed all judgment under him, and he is going to judge the world. That day's coming that God has set aside and appointed, and he's given it unto the Lord Jesus Christ, because God says, I have ordained it. Paul told him that there's coming that appointed day. If you don't repent, there's coming a day when you're going to stand before God Almighty, and you're going to be judged, and that person you will stand before is Jesus Christ. And because God gave us the assurance of it in the fact that he raised him from the dead. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Boy, I tell you. Woo. Awesome. Awesome. Well, now we come to the close of this. Let's see how they respond. Now, those of you, you've heard the message today. Those on television, radio, internet, you've heard the message. What are you going to do with it? There's no ignorance. Can't excuse it. You have a responsibility. What are you going to do with it? Well, let's look and see what they did. Are you ready? All right. They're the first group. And when they heard of the, oh, here we go again. I love it. When they heard of the what? The resurrection of the dead. Notice the first group. What did they do? There's the mockers. They mocked him at the crucifixion that day and mocked him and told him, if you be the Christ, you be the Savior, you be the Son of God, then prove it and come down off the cross. No, he proved it by staying on the cross. That's how he proved it, because he knew 3 days later he would arise from the grave. Thank God he stayed on the cross. Amen. But there'd be the mockers. Peter talked about the mockers too in the last days. There'll be mockers and scoffers that'll come and say, oh, where is the sign of his coming? We've heard that from our forefathers that fell asleep a long time ago. Well, go ahead. You keep mocking. You keep scoffing. And I'm telling you, one of these days, there's a trumpet that's going to sound so loud. There's a shout that's going to shout so loud that those that have died in the Lord Jesus Christ, born again, buried in these graves, buried in, I don't care what you want to call them, the ones above the ground. Mausoleums. I don't care if you're born, if you're planted there. I don't care if you're planted here. I don't care if you've been buried at sea on a ship. I'm telling you, if you're saved and born again, you're going to hear a shout so loud. You're going to hear a trumpet so loud that it's going to wake you up from sleeping, and you're going to rise and come up and meet the Lord in the air. And those of us that are alive, we're going with them. Hallelujah. Now, you can mock that all you want to. And I have a lot of people that do. Go right ahead. And guess what? You're going to wake up one morning and I'm going to be gone. You're going to wake up and turn on Channel 55 and COX and all these places. And where is that big loudmouth preacher? I don't hear him anymore. No, I'm gone. I'm gone. And you're left behind. And without excuse. You know why? Because you heard the gospel today. Hello? Well, there's that group. Then here, look at the next group. And others said, we will hear thee again on this matter. In other words, they put it off. Oh, how many people today put it off? Put it off. Another time, some other time. Right now, I got to sow my wild oats. Right now, I got to live it up. Right now, I'm after pleasure, recreation, entertainment. I'm living up the world. Man, I'm young. I got life in front of me and ahead of me. I got a long ways to go. I'm not like you old codger up there behind the pulpit today. Man, I'm just a teenager. I'm just a young adult. Hey, you don't know if you can breathe your next breath. You have no guarantee of tomorrow. You have no promise of tomorrow. You have no promise or guarantee of today. What you have, though, is right now. Well, I'll just put it off. Well, notice the response of the preacher. Does everybody see what the preacher did? Those that mocked it? Those that said, we'll consider this another time and put it off? What did the preacher do? He turned away from them and left. I'm telling you, there's going to become a time there's not going to be preachers around to tell you about the Lord. They won't be here. They're going to be gone. Those that know the Lord, know Christ. And those that are left behind, they're going to have you coming over to their churches and teaching you survival courses on how to survive. And they're going to be asking you, how much food you got? Where's your 25-year shelf life food? You need to share it with all of us now, because that's what Jesus would have you to do. No, what Jesus would have you do is repent and believe and go to heaven. That's what Jesus would have you do. So the preacher left. So there's a group that mocked. There's a group that said later, some other time. We don't have time for all this right now. We'll think about it and consider it later. So the preacher left. But oh, bless God, verse 34. Howbeit, certain men clave unto him and talked to me. And believed. How about you today? Will you believe the Lord Jesus Christ today? Heads bowed and eyes are closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Will you believe today? Some of them went after Paul and they believed the message. How about you? Will you be willing to confess with your mouth the Lord today? Will you be willing to believe in your heart today that God raised him from the dead and invite him in to come into your heart and life to save you and to change you, to be your Lord and Savior and take you to heaven someday when you die? Friend, you've heard it. There's no excuse. You're in one of those six people groups, which one you're in today. But it doesn't matter which one you're in. I want to tell you something. Listen to me. Look at the television. Listen to me. I can't tell you any more honest and truthful than I can. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. And you need him right now. You need him right now. For the Bible says today is a day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. You need Jesus right now. And we want to give you that opportunity right now. If you just pray with us, It's not the prayer. Those are words communicating with God. It's putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. But pray this with us. That's what we're going to do. Dear God, that's right. Go ahead. Some of you here in the auditorium as well. I confess with my mouth, you are the Lord from heaven. I do now believe in my heart that you raised Jesus from the dead. I believe he died on the cross for my sins. I believe he was paid the penalty for my sin. I believe he took my place and he was buried and that he rose again. And I ask you to forgive me and to cleanse me, and he will. And I believe that with all my heart. And so right now, I do call upon you, Lord Jesus. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I receive you. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So, Lord Jesus, I call upon your name, and I receive you as my Lord and Savior into my heart and life today. And I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. And we're going to trust many of you got saved today and came to know the Lord and to trust Christ as your Savior. Thank you so much for watching and listening and tuning in with us. And may we see you again. If we don't see you now, we'll see you in glory. We'll see you in the trip on the way up, or we'll see you in heaven somewhere walking on the streets of glory, and we'll fellowship with you. But in the meantime, may the grace of God be upon you. May the peace of God rule in your hearts, and may Jesus shine upon your face, his countenance, in Jesus' name. Amen.